And one of them, Bob told me this morning, Bob Anthony. I don't know if I can do it well. I'll try. But he said there was this teacher, and she was trying to convince the children to buy this class photo. And she said, you'll want to keep these photos because years later you'll be able to say, see, there's Johnny. He's a lawyer. And see, there's Sally. You know, she's a doctor. And see, there's this person and that person. Another kid pipes up and said, see, there's our teacher, and she's dead. I thought that was cute. See if you like this one, too. A wife invited some people to dinner. At the table, she turned to their six-year-old daughter and said, would you like to say the blessing? I wouldn't know what to say, the girl replied. Just say what you hear mommy say, the wife answered. The daughter bowed her head and said, Lord, why on earth did I invite all these people? Be careful. Amen. Once again, happy Mother's Day. I was going to do an entire Mother's Day thing, but you know, I try to follow what I believe is the leading of the Lord. I want to talk a little bit about mothers, and then I want to start with what I believe is probably the greatest Mother's Day present of all, and that's how I'm going to start something called How to Study the Bible Through the Eyes of Grace. And so many people have asked me, how do you study the Bible? And we're going to start on that, but before we do, I want to say a few things about mamas. That means mothers, okay? And first of all, you know, let me just say a couple things. I was thinking about Deborah. Remember Deborah in the book of Judges? She was a prophetess and a leader in Israel. And something that really ministered to me, if I could have Judges chapter 5, verse 7 up there, please, and we'll get started. This is so exciting. He's so exciting. You know that? He's just so exciting. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Do you know that? You are right with him. If you're born again, you are right with him. You know, weakness has to go. Fear has to go. Lack has to go. Did you know that? Because as he is, so are you in this world. And the more that that drops into your heart and you see who you are, the more excited you get. Well, anyhow, with that said, look at this. Judges. The inhabitants of the villages ceased. They ceased in Israel until that I, Deborah, arose, and that I arose a mother in Israel. Now, Deborah's name means bee. And one of the things I looked up said that that was her characteristic, that she was busy as a bee. And let me say something. Some of you know that I messed with honeybees and did as a kid. And, of course, then Michael and I, Michael really messes with them. And yesterday we had something. I never told you this today. I never even told Michael this. But for the second time in my life, I seen honeybee swarm in the air. And we seen it right there by Arby's. I had the whole family with me. And all of a sudden, what's that? And here a swarm of bees come by. And this is how cool the Lord is. We pulled in Arby's, Jen and Gracie went in Arby's, and Joel and I took off to see if they landed somewhere so I could catch them and put them in a box and have another colony. Long story short, well, we didn't find him, but I ran into a guy that I worked with over 12 years ago that lives back there. I thought that was cool. You know, God orders your steps. Do you know that? Right place, right time. God orders your steps. That's powerful. You know how on your side the Father is? The creator of the universe is on your side. I say this all the time. To the world, he's God. To you, he's Father. Amen. Well, anyhow, I want to say this about Deborah. You know, even whether you're a mother or not, you're called to be a mother in Israel. What does a mother in Israel mean? Well, first of all, let me say this. The family of God is the Israel of God. Amen. If you're born again, the Bible says you are a part of the family of God. And a mother is somebody who nurtures. A mother is somebody who cares. Whether you're male or female, whether you have biological children, adopted children, or no children, married, single, whatever, you are called with a motherly type mentality. Amen. You're called to care for people. But this is interesting. I looked up some of these other translations of Judges chapter 5, verse 7. And listen to this. The rulers ceased in Israel until she arose. Because Deborah, it says, champions there were none in Israel. In other words, do you know that if you and I don't operate, Paul said it like this in 1 Corinthians 4:15. He said, you've had many teachers, but you haven't had many fathers. Parents. Amen. You know, parents guide. You know, parents, you know, all those types of things. Listen to some of these other translations. Dead were Israel's villages until Deborah rose. Until you arose, O Deborah. Until you played the mother's part. And I want to say this to you. A lot of times, until we play the mother's part, until we care for people, until we do those things, until we impart the teaching that's in us, I was thinking about what Paul said. Woe be unto me if I preach not the gospel. And I used to always look at that and said, woe be unto me, man. I'm going to stand before the Lord and I'm going to have to give an account. And here again, I'm not here to debate that. But I think it's woe be unto me if I don't allow what's in me to come out and bless other people. You know, the one that does, it's not woe in the sense that you'll go to hell, that type of thing. It's woe in the sense that, you know, you'll blow up. Amen. I used to think, well, if I had it to do over, I don't know that I'd pastor all that kind of stuff. But, you know, I know I would. You know why? Because you got to. That's who you are. I'm not saying everybody's called a pastor, but you are the servant of the Lord, the Bible says. Must not be full of strife. Let me show you that. 2 Timothy chapter 2. We'll start with verse 23. Watch this. 2 Timothy 2:23. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid. Well, we could camp there. You ever been around people and all they want to do is argue? Don't look at your wife or husband. It says avoid them, knowing that they gender or breed strifes. Next verse. But and the servant of the Lord must not strive. Watch this, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient. Stop right there. You know what apt to teach means? Skillful in teaching. That's not just the pastor. That's not just the evangelist. That's not just the traveling teacher. That's everybody. Must be skillful. That's why I'm starting this series. I mean, I had another message I was working on Monday, and Tuesday the Lord was pressing me. Pressing me. I could feel it in my heart. You need to teach on how to study the Bible through the eyes of grace. And by the way, I'm going to try to talk slow and meticulously because we're going to take this down and Jen's going to try to type it out and we're going to try to put it in a booklet or book type form to give to people to help them. Amen? So many people ask, how do you study the Bible? We're going to talk about that. How do you study? It's not going to be super in depth, but it's going to have some depth in it. We're going to use many examples. You're going to know after this series how to study the Bible. And you'll come up with your own little way of doing things. Amen? For years, I never knew a Strong's Concordance. I didn't understand that when you go to the back of a Strong's Concordance that it's only the italicized words that are the actual Hebrew or Greek definition. I never knew that for years. No one ever told me that. Did you know that? Don't raise your hand. That's okay. And it's only about 4 to 5 words at the absolute most because Strong's was not trying to define the Hebrew and Greek. He was just giving a basic boiled down definition. There's other books that you can go to that will help you. That section's called Study Aids, Books That Bless. Amen. I tell people this, do you know that your English Bible's not inspired? Well, blasphemy, no, the Hebrew and Greek is. English is a translation. Amen. Now, there's reputable translations and there's non-reputable translations. We're going to get into all that. We're going to talk about it. And here again, don't take things because I say it. You search the scriptures and you make sure those things are so. Amen? In other words, you have your relationship with God. This will challenge you. But anyhow, so the servant of the Lord must be skillful in teaching. Next verse. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. Well, we could camp here too. You know, there's people that oppose themselves. You ever dealt with any of them? I don't know why. I believe that because that's what they've always said. That's a terrible reason to believe something. I grew up believing stuff, and I look back now, and I don't know how in the world I ever believed that. We won't mention the church's name. You all know. Okay. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, next verse, and that they may recover themselves, that they may sober up. Recover themselves out of the snare of the devil who are taken captive by him at his will. That word captive is where we get our English word zoo. Zugreo. It's where we get zoo. And it's interesting. I remember looking at this and it means that the enemy's method is to confuse, how does it say? Confuse the senses which ultimately paralyzes the will. I forget. There's a thing that it says. The enemy's method is he confuses your senses about the things of God, which ultimately paralyzes your will. And that's what he does. And it's all based on one thing. Everybody say one thing. A lack of knowledge. Your greatest enemy is not the devil. Your greatest enemy is ignorance. Let me say that again, or back up and re-say it. The devil's defeated. Read Colossians 2. He's completely defeated. But the enemy is ignorance. Amen. I shared something on our Thursday night Bible study that I thought was really powerful. And one of the old timers said, there's a great price to pay for staying out of the will of God. For example, oppression. People are oppressed. But the price you pay is not from God. God's totally blessed all of us. Amen. But if I never know about it, and I live this in this room, and listen, it's not about what you have or don't have in the natural. It affects those things. But there's a lot of people got a lot of things in the natural, but they're very poor people. Amen? It's about this internal disposition that knows that the creator of the universe lives in me. You know, God wants us to be God inside minded. Amen. All right, let me say a few more things about mothers. Go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7 from the Amplified Bible, please. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. And we behaved ourselves gently when we were among you, like a devoted mother. This is Paul talking. Paul's a guy. Like a devoted mother. Watch this. Nursing and cherishing her own children. Amen. You know, I got to say that, you know, one of the things about Mother's Day, can I just speak from a little bit from my past? I there was a day, not with Jen and I, when I was married before. I say that because some people choke on it. I didn't ever wanted a divorce, but we lost babies. That was very painful. And every time there was a Mother's Day or Father's Day, it really hurt. So I'm very sensitive to that pain. Amen? But let me say this to you. If you may be a woman and you may or may not have children, you may not want children, that's not the point. But you're called to be a mother in Israel. Are you hearing? You're called to be a mother in Israel. And it's more than just birthing children. It's raising, it's nourishing, it's cherishing people, it's helping people. I read a thing one time that I never forgot. We need to celebrate people, not just tolerate them. People are awesome. Now, I know they're goofy too. I've often said life would be okay if it just wasn't for all those people. But guess what? That's life. That's life. Amen. It makes it exciting. Another obstacle to overcome. Hallelujah. So we behaved ourselves gently. That's powerful. When we were among you like a devoted mother nursing and cherishing her own children. One more. No, two more. Proverbs chapter 14. No, I'm going to save that one. Go to Titus chapter 2, verse 3 through 5. Titus 2, verse, and we'll do it from the Amplified also. Titus chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. Bid the older woman similarly to be reverent and devout in their deportment as becomes those engaged in sacred services, not slanderers or slaves to drink. They are to give good counsel and be teachers of what is right and noble. Next verse. So they wisely train the young women. The older women are to teach or train the young women. The older women are to teach and train the young women. I thought that was the pastor's job. No, that's the older women's job. Amen. Now, that doesn't mean necessarily you can be 35 and be an older woman. Or you can be 85 and be a younger woman. I'm not talking about age in the sense that we need the older women to teach the younger women. This is what mothering's about. We talk about Mother's Day and we think, I had a kid. I'm a mom. Well, you're a mom in that sense, but that don't mean you're acting like a mother. Mother's raising that kid. If there's one thing grieves me in our society, is kids having kids. Amen? I told you what Larry the Cable Guy said, didn't I? You know that prophet, Larry the Cable Guy? Yeah, I heard him on an interview and he said, I'll tell you what, my cousin, he's real strict with his kids. You know he won't even let his 12-year-old daughter drink a beer in front of her daughter? You know that prophet? Anyhow, so they wisely train the young women to be sane and sober of mind, temperate, disciplined, and to love their husbands and their children. You know the word love means to be a friend to phileo their husbands. Isn't that powerful? Next verse. To be self-controlled. This is what the older women are to impart to the younger women. The older women are, you know, I'm thinking of one particular situation in a church, not this one, but I've seen in a church situation where there was so much gossip going on in the nursery that one couple ended up getting a divorce. You know, one of the things that we really refrain from with Jen's Bible study, and the reason it's open not to just women, because we, so many times, and here again, I love men, I love women, I'm not saying this to be chauvinist, but so many times, my wife will tell you the same thing. Women get around and they just talk about how bad their husbands are. We ain't about that. We're going to talk about how good Jesus is. Everybody's got issues, amen? But so many times we want to major on the issues and go on and on. You know what that does? We give mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to those types of things, and they just get bigger. What you focus on gets bigger. When the Bible says magnify the Lord, how do you magnify somebody that fills heaven and earth, Jeremiah 23, 24? You do that in your experience. You magnify him. You talk about him. You exalt him. You magnify the Lord in this realm. You can't magnify God to God, but you can magnify him in your experience. In a negative sense, if I'm always talking about, well, my wife, yeah, I tell you what, if she needs to do that, I know what you mean. My wife too, That's not good. But see, people do that. This is part of being a mother in Israel, being a mother in the body of Christ. Older women, teach the younger women, shut your mouth. Smith Wigglesworth, they used to come up to him and people would say, well, I want to tell you about so-and-so. And he'd look at his watch and say, okay, go ahead. As long as you talk about them, we're going to pray as long as we talk about them. We're going to pray for them. Keep going. Okay? Keep going. Think how things would change. I'm going to say, oh, I got so many things. I got like 10 pages here. We are going to do it, but I want to say this to you. You will never rise above your testimony or your confession. Never. Never. That's why people in the body of Christ who Jesus has purchased total victory for walk in defeat, because they're constantly talking about how bad it is in this realm, the physical realm, instead of how good it is in his realm, which is the spirit. If you begin to talk about who you are in Christ, it begins to change things. Your faith will only rise to the level of your testimony. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12, verse 11, and I'm getting excited. They overcome him by two things. Everybody say two things. The blood of the Lamb. That's position. That's what he did. And what? The word of our testimony. Whoa. That's you, what you do. You agree with what he did. The old timer says, if you're afraid to confess your oneness with Jesus, if you're afraid to confess his victory, then it will not be yours in your experience, even though it is yours positionally. It's all yours. You could not be any more complete than you are now, but if you decide, well, I'm not going to say that. If you murmur negative, guess what? The enemy takes advantage of that and brings that down to the level of where you're speaking. Are you hearing? I told my wife today, I was walking around thinking, my word, we're blessed. You know what I was doing? See, that seals the deal. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. You begin to declare, this is what God says about me. And not just think it, you begin to speak it out your mouth. And guess what? It begins to manifest. Whew. Man, that's good news. You'll never rise above your testimony, the words of your mouth. Never. Listen to how people talk. Listen to how you talk. Not you, nobody here. I listen to how I talk. I tell Jen, I listen to how we talk. We're in this all the time. And I'm telling you, we don't talk where we want to walk. You need to talk where you want to walk. Amen? Your faith will never rise above your testimony as to what Jesus has done. That's powerful. That is powerful, man. That rocks my world. Well, anyhow, so the older women are to teach young women to be self-controlled, chaste, homemakers, good-natured. Not during that time of the month there, Myrtle. Sorry. Hog wash. Oh, you're a guy. You just don't understand. You don't understand what guys go through. We can all say that. We can all say that. You have the power. The creator of the universe lives in you. There's not a time of the month that gives you an excuse to act like Satan. There isn't. I'm tired of this stuff. I'm telling you, when I flip on Fox News once in a while, and man, there's so many commercials because you know it's big money and all, as are all of them. I have to turn it off. Them commercials are deadly. They are deadly. I literally can't stand it. Man, they give you so many diseases in just that half hour commercial. It's about what they are. I mean, you're side effects. You've got everything, and it's this, and are you this age? And they have shows on, and you know, aching joints above 55. I'm thinking, I just see those times thinking, what is going on here? Where's the life? I'll tell you where the life at. It's in the Word of God. Right. Some people are going to say you're a fanatic. Let them say it. Who cares? I am a fanatic. To be self-controlled, chase. Let me say something about fanatics. You ever see those people at football games? paint themselves up. They're out there to go, no! I'm thinking, that's weird. I don't care what you say. There's no football team I like that much. The older women teach young women to be self-controlled, chaste, homemakers, good-natured, kind-hearted, adapting and subordinating themselves to their husbands. This is in the Lord. We say, well, what if he's not a Christian? Well, in the parts that don't violate the things of God, yes. Because 1 Peter chapter 3 talks about you can win him to the Lord by that meek and gentle spirit. Amen? But this is powerful right here. Do you know that any, or may not be popular, but it's still true. Do you know that any organism with two heads is a freak? You know that? What did Jen said this today? She goes, I just need to learn to listen to my husband. She said that. She did. You know what? This may, even if I'm wrong, my heart's right. You know what I'm saying? And that doesn't mean she doesn't have an opinion, and that doesn't mean she's, you know, hey, honey, you're going out in your underwear. I am not, you know. Don't tell me, woman. I'm not talking about stupidity. We're to submit one to another, it says in Ephesians 5. But I'm saying there's a structure in the body of Christ. And it's for the good of the husband and the good of the wife. Amen? Hallelujah. But I think that's powerful, adapting and subordinating themselves to their husbands. My wife said something really good. She goes, man, I'm amazed. I hear all these scriptures. I hear you quote. I think, man, I'm knowing them too. You know why? We're adapting to one another. Amen. That's powerful. To their husband, that the word of God may not be exposed to reproach, blasphemed, or discredited. You know, when you live a life that's contrary to who the Bible says you are, it sends confusing signals to the world. You know that? How many people today are not going to church anywhere, not doing anything because of what they've seen in church? All right. Amen. See, but the whole point of it is, this is who you are. If I say one thing and then I live another way, then that's a confusing signal. You know what I think the world really wants? And my wife and I, we'll talk about different preachers, even if we don't agree with their message. It's just something about a husband and wife having a good relationship that the world yearns for. Amen? Do you know all of my life, I look back at it, and I grew up in a particular church that if he was going to be a minister, you couldn't marry. Doctrine of demons, according to 1 Timothy chapter 4. Forbidding to marry, commanding is, you know. And I remember, you know, I don't want to be a priest because I want to get married. I don't want to have just a housekeeper. I told you about the couple that went for marriage counseling, right? They went for marriage counseling to the priest, and they said, well, you need to stop living with your woman. And the guy said, well, I'll get rid of my housekeeper when you get rid of yours. It's religion, people. It's stupid. Call it what it is. This stuff is foolishness. And the world knows it. Oh, Chris, you're going to offend. I'm not trying to offend. I'm trying to wake people up. Most people know it, but, oh, we got to be politically correct. Let's just be honest. Amen? It's not in the Bible. It's a doctrine of demons. If you choose not to marry, that's your choice, like the Apostle Paul. But if somebody says you can't marry in order to be in the clergy, it's a doctrine of demons. Read 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 on down. You'll see it. Amen. Hallelujah. See, what the devil looks like a lot of times is religion. One more. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 1. Proverbs 14, verse 1. It says, a wise woman, watch this, every wise woman builds her house. And we're talking about motherly, being motherly. I've heard people say that in many, many situations, you will find that the tone of the home is set by the mother. Many times. Do you know moms can, if they have more than one child, they can sow division between their children? Did you know that? Or they can bring them together. You know, my mom is not perfect, but she's not here. But I will say this about her. She never, and I mean never, runs any of my other five siblings down to me or vice versa. Never. Never. And I commend her for that. She never sits there and says, well, you know, Steve this or that. Other than joking around, we do that. You know, like Scott, he leaves food on the table or like on the high, right next to him on a, what, not by, right next to his chair. What do they call that where you set a lamp on? End table. He'll leave a sandwich there and he leaves it there for like years and he thinks, don't move it because that saves the seat. I'm kidding. So we make fun of that. That's funny. But you know, to run, see, you can build or you can destroy. Amen. So every wise woman builds her house, but the foolish one tears it down, look at this, with her own hands. You know, one of the things we say, God's never going to judge you. But you know, I can make stupid choices and I can cause problems with my own doing. Amen? Amen. All right. That's it. And that took us quite a while. But I'm actually going to start right now with this message. I believe this is the greatest Mother's Day present of all time. And that is how to study the Bible through the eyes of grace. Like I said earlier, many people have asked, how do you study the Bible? That's a good question. I mean, there's things I'm going to share in here I wish somebody would have told me years ago. No one did. You had to figure it out on your own. So I'm going to try to, and what we're going to do, Nevin, Minuteman Press, is we're going to try to type this, put it in some kind of booklet, and it's the goal is not to be a New York Times bestseller. The goal is to give it to people, to help people. That's the only goal. Who knows if it probably might be a booklet. It may be several volumes. We don't know. I mean, you can go on and on as I use different examples. But anyhow, how to study the Bible through the eyes of grace. And I'm going to share, I wrote a whole bunch of stuff here. First of all, I want to talk about the importance of studying the Bible. Let me say this. E.W. Kenyon has a thing that he talks in New Creation Realities about the danger. Everybody say the danger. Of esteeming the Bible as a common book. That's the danger of esteeming the Bible as a common book. The Bible is not a common book. The Bible is the literal written word of God. Now, it points to the living word of God. And that would be, of course, Jesus. But the Bible is the written word of God. Okay? Everybody got that? The Bible, I've heard people say, well, the Bible contains the word of God, but it's not the word of God. That's false. The Bible doesn't contain the word of God. The Bible is the word of God. People say, well, I want to hear God's voice. Here it is. Here's God's voice. I want to hear God's voice. Here it is. This is God's voice. I was thinking recently, I think I'm finally understanding how to pray. You say, finally? After over 25 years as a Christian? Finally. The Bible says, let me show you how to pray. Watch this. John chapter 16, verse 23. Look at this. I could show you many verses, but I'm going to show you this. This is so powerful. John 16, 23. Now, don't skim over this. This is the word of God to you. To you. It's the word of God. Watch this. And in that day, the day of the new covenant. In that day, watch this. Jesus speaking, ye shall ask me, Jesus, nothing. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever, ye shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you. Whew. You don't have to ask Jesus. You go directly to the Father in his name. Now, I'm going to say something here. Do you know the Bible says in Philippians chapter 2 that God the Father gave Jesus that name? You know why? For you and I. Don't want to get too deep. Hang with me. Next verse. Watch this. Hitherto, or up until now, have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. And in John chapter 14, verses 13 and 14, it says that when prayers are answered and they manifest, guess what? The Father is glorified in the Son. And here, you know what glorifies the Father? When your prayers are answered. I know what some of you are thinking. Well, I've done that and I haven't seen. Listen, here again, we're going to talk about the will of the Father. Jesus said in John 15, verse 7, if you abide in me, and my words abide in you, that means live, reside, or dwell, then you'll ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Amen? Well, I'm just praying that the Lord would give me that guy's wife. Ain't going to happen. Not provided for in the atonement. Amen? Redemption does not provide for that. Well, anyhow, so I want to look at the importance of studying the Bible. Number one, go to 2 Timothy 2:15. Some of you know these verses. That's okay. We're going anyhow. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Study. Study, buddy. I was trying to think of a rhyme. Study. Study. Doesn't say read. That's part of studying, but it says study. Ponder. Meditate upon. Think upon. Study. In the Greek, it's a aorist tense. Make it a once and for all ready, settled fact to be persistent in your zeal to study God's word. Study to show thyself approved unto God. Now, this isn't studying so God will approve you. It's studying to show yourself that you've already been approved in Christ. See, once again, your greatest enemy is ignorance. My greatest enemy is ignorance. I say it all the time. It's not foolish to be ignorant, but it's very, very, very foolish to remain ignorant. I refuse to remain ignorant. How about you? I refuse to remain ignorant. Hallelujah. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that doesn't need to be ashamed or needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now we're going to get into rightly dividing. Hallelujah. I looked up Webster's dictionary definition of study. Listen to this. Study as the application of the mind to the acquisition of knowledge. The application of the mind to the acquisition of knowledge. Let me say this to you. We talked last week. Let me show you this one. Jump over to 2nd. We've talked a couple times. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. Watch this. This will get so good. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. Grace. What is grace? Grace is favor. 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 And peace are multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. The flip side of that coin is grace and peace are not multiplied unto you through a lack of knowledge. Now watch this. So the definition of study, according to Webster's dictionary, it's the application of the mind to the acquisition of knowledge. In other words, it has the idea of effort. 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 Do you know what I find? You can get up, and I've been doing this, and there's just verses that are on your mind and saying, Lord, what do you want me to meditate on today? What do you want me to think about today? Because see, it's where your mind goes. That's where your life is going. Did you know that? And let me show you something that I was meditating on last week. I'll just show you. Go to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15. Look at this. Ephesians 4, verse 15. Watch this. But speaking the truth in love. Now, you could camp here. May grow up into him in all things which is the head, even Christ. So we speak the truth in love. We grow up into him. Now go to the next verse. This is what I was meaning. From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted that by that which every joint supplies. Every joint supplies. Watch this. According to the effectual or effective working in the measure of every part. In other words, it's according to how much of his life is working in the measure of every part. Now watch this. Makes increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Now, I was just taking this verse, and I was just thinking about it. And I was thinking about every joint supplies, and it's according to the effectual, the effective working in the measure of every part. Romans chapter 12, verse 3, you know it. It says, unto every man's given the measure of faith. But if that's working in me and that's working in you, the body automatically builds itself up in love. Are you hearing me? But see, the point of it is, I can be thinking about something like this or another verse that the Lord gives me. You could take Isaiah 26, verse 3. God will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind, his imagination is stayed upon him because he trusts in thee. You know, when your mind stayed upon him, that's equated to trusting in him. Isn't that powerful? You can take that and you can, but see, here again, I say it like this. Many people are physically not lazy, but mentally very lazy. You hearing what I'm saying? This takes effort. See, it's already done deal, but it's effort. The Bible, I'm going to give it to you. Go to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 11. Watch this. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 11. Back up one verse. For he that has entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Now watch this. Let us labor, therefore. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. Labor to what? Enter that rest. Hang with me. All right. So study means as the acquisition, the application of the mind to the acquisition of knowledge. It means any ideas of a painter, etc., for his future instruction or improvement. For his future instruction or improvement. You know, the life you're living today is what you sowed yesterday in your thinking. If you're real insecure, it's because you've been thinking insecure thoughts. That should excite you. What's the remedy? Find out who God says you are. Amen? You know, I used to be ridiculously insecure. Now, I still have that. I'm growing. But I'll tell you, now I'm finding out, no, I keep thinking, man, I just think I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. That means I have the ability to stand in the presence of the creator of the universe with no sense of inferiority, shame, guilt, or anything because of what Jesus has done. See, I mean, you could take that and you could go on and on and on, and it never ends. I have peace with God. I was thinking the other day, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. But here's what it is. Here's what it is, guys. It's righteousness, and it's peace, and it's joy, but it's located somewhere. It's in the Holy Ghost. Now, what does that mean? You tell me. Come on. Well, I don't know. That's for preachers. No, it's for you too. I'm trying to challenge you. This stuff doesn't happen by osmosis. People say, how do you remember so many Bible verses? I apply myself. It's deep, I know. But you don't understand, I'm not called to be a preacher. Doesn't matter. God's got verses for you throughout the day. He wants to talk to you. He wants to show you Jesus in them. See, this is not laws we keep. This is life that keeps us. This is his life. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let me move on. So it's the idea of a painter, etc., for his future instruction or improvement. It's a room set apart for study. That's also under study. It means to apply the mind closely to a subject. To apply the mind closely to a subject. Watch this. It means to endeavor diligently. It means to examine closely in order to learn thoroughly. And it means devote one's thoughts to. You can tell what people are thinking about by how they talk. This all going around. I'm serious. You ever been around? You can't get around them. I'm talking about believers. I'm thinking, what's wrong with you? See, some people need a Holy Ghost slap. They do. What does God say about that? Can I whine with you? Let me whine. Come on. We were out there examining a Luna Moth before service, and my car's leaking antifreeze. Thank God Sam Coy came. You know what? And there's a temptation, but you know what I love to say? This will all work out towards for our good. I don't know how. But you know what? You want to worry about it? There's a lot of things to worry about. But what does God say? He says, I am right. We would stop worrying if we knew that his ability was our ability. Weakness would be a thing of the past. Well, somebody get excited. You're not going to know this, though, if you just, well, you know, the preacher says that, but, you know, we've heard that before. We already know that. Do you? Do I? Hallelujah. Glory to God. As I said earlier, while reading is a part of study, while reading is a part of what it means to study, one can read and not absorb. How many times have you ever read the Bible and you think, man, I never read that before? Amen? I told my wife one time, was I sleeping when I heard that? What happened there? See, you got to apply. That's why sometimes you just sit there, and that's why meditation, we're going to get into that. When we get into the Holy Spirit, we're going to talk about meditation and what it means to meditate, what it means to roll it over in your mind, to roll it out your mouth, all those types of things. That's how it becomes a part of you. See, you know what? One of the reasons I'm so excited, believe me, it's not because everybody's always smiling, although some of you do a good job. But sometimes there's all kinds of things come at you and try to tell you, well, you're crazy, you're this, you're that, but you have to go back to the Word. This is what God says about me. This is what he says. Everything Jesus is, I am. I'm going to say it to you. If you're born again, the only difference between you and Jesus is he knew who he was and you don't. That's the only difference. He put you in him. Now, if that don't make you excited, you're dead. If that don't light your fire, your wood's wet. Amen? That's what he did. He literally put you in him. You know, for people to think that they don't need Jesus is insane. Man, that's what the whole cry of the book of Job. How can a man, a frail man, stand before God without a mediator? That's why God had to become man. And for people to teach universalism and think, well, we're just all saved because, you know, God's love and all that, it's insane. It's antichrist. It's demonic. He must be received. If I stand outside, there is no life outside of Christ. None. It's all in him. Whew, man, that stuff's good. Hallelujah. So you can read and still not absorb what they are reading. I'm going to address the importance of meditation as we get further along in this. But for now, I want to just simply discuss the importance of Bible study. I want you to look with me at Acts chapter 17 and verse 11. This is powerful. I call this the attitude of altitude. The attitude of altitude. These were the ones that says that Paul and them came to, and it says they were more noble than those in Thessalonica in that they received the word with all readiness, with all eagerness. They received the word. Now watch this. And they searched the scriptures on Christmas and Easter. If they had time to get to church. They searched the scriptures on Sundays. They searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. You know what? The more I go in this walk, the more I believe that we are exactly, you can receive as much of understanding of who you are in Christ as you want. You can choose to be stale or you can choose to go on. Amen. And I want to say it again, and I don't have it in front of me, but the old timer said something so good. He said, there's such a danger of being out of the will of the Father. Not from God. God will never judge you again because he's already judged you in Christ. But there's all kinds of junk out here. Amen. And you know the Lord wants you protected from that? You know the Lord never wants you sick? I love saying that. You know the Lord never wants you in an accident? You know that? I'm not saying the enemy won't try or some situation won't try, but God wants you protected. Read Psalm 91. There was the 91st Brigade in World War I went through like three of the bloodiest battles in World War I where other units lost 90% of their people, and they were the unit that prayed the 91st Psalm every day. And they stood on that every day. They had no casualties. That's powerful. That's powerful. You all have faith, but as I said earlier, your faith will never rise above your testimony. You overcome by what Jesus did, the blood of the Lamb, and the word of your testimony about what Jesus did. That's your agreement. Can two walk together, Amos says, except they be agreed? That's why it says he's the apostle and high priest in Hebrews 3:1 of our confession of what we declare about what he did. Your faith will only go as high as your testimony. There's that name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. What the heck? Write a check. Amen. It's what the Word of God teaches. I love it. All right, where was we at? So this leads me to what I call the attitude of altitude. And this is amazing. You've heard me say this many, many times. It's important to be teachable. You know what locks people's minds more than anything else is what they think they know. Religion is one of the most dangerous traps. There's another great danger of mental assent, where we mental assent to things. Oh, yeah, I believe that. But we never confess it. We never act upon it. We never say it. We just give, oh, yeah, I believe God's a healer. But the first thing we do when we have a headache is run to the medicine cabinet. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with running the medicine cabinet. Don't hear that. But I'm saying stand on the word of God while you're running to the medicine cabinet. Declare by these stripes and these pills I'm healed. Thank you for these pills. Amen. Stop taking your cues from the world. You are blessed. You are healed. You are prosperous because God says it. That settles it. Whether I ever see a manifestation in my life or not, it's a done deal, baby. I was looking at my wife when I said baby. So it's important to be teachable. Look at Proverbs 13, verse 10. Jiminy Pete's, this time. I better get this out so I don't go too long. what did I say? Proverbs 13 and verse 10. Watch this. Only by pride comes contention. I quoted that first part of the verse for years. Only by pride comes contention. But notice the rest of it. But with the well-advised is wisdom. And one day I felt like the Lord showed me. He said, in order to be well-advised, you got to be well-advisable. I said this Thursday, you know what's hurting the body of Christ in what we call the grace gospel, which is the one true gospel, is people are divided. I was talking to Brother Lynn. That's one thing I love about Lynn. I don't want to be camp captive. Amen? I don't want to be, well, you're part of that camp. You're part of that camp. I'm part of the gospel revolution. And if you're born again, you're my brother and sister in Christ. It's that simple. Well, what if they don't agree? Who cares? Amen? See, that's the problem we get in camps. Well, we can't. That's becoming a denomination. And anybody that doesn't agree with you, I was talking to a guy the other day, and he was telling me about this preacher in this particular denomination, and he's retiring, I guess, or whatever, and he's not going to be at that particular church anymore. And they said, well, he's not allowed to go at that church anymore because the denomination says you're not allowed to stay at that church if you've been a preacher there. And I'm thinking, what if the Holy Spirit's leading him to stay there and help? Stupid. Stupid. That's why I say, so what abomination, I mean denomination, are you in? I did that accidentally one time, and I thought, man, that's good. I like it. I think I'll use that. One more. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 2. I'm going to watch my time. I am going to watch it. Okay, I'm good. Because 1 Corinthians 8, verse 2, watch this. If any man thinks he knows anything, he does nothing yet as he ought to know. If you think you know something, you don't know anything as you should know it. Amen. How to study the Bible through the eyes of grace. In other words, it doesn't mean you don't know anything, but you don't know it as you ought to know it. In other words, all of God's revelation is progressive. Through the eyes of grace. Let me get this one quick. John chapter 1, verse 17. I'm debating on 16, but we might do that one. We'll do 16. And of his fullness have we all received, and grace, as Joel says, my son, grace on top of grace. Favor on top of favor. In other words, when one grace is done, there's another one to replace it. It's constant. This is new covenant. Now go to the next verse. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. That's why we say how to study the Bible through the eyes of grace, through the eyes of the new covenant. A lot of people read the Bible and they see a bunch of laws. I don't recommend you start with Leviticus when you read the Bible. Amen? Because those are all pictures and shadows of who was to come. I like to say it like this. We need to stop hugging the shadow. What do you mean by that? We'll go to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, about verse 14. We'll start there. Colossians 2. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. This is what Jesus did. That word ordinances means requirements. In the New King James, it says that. That's talking about the law. That was against us. The law was against us because man couldn't keep it, which was contrary to us. It took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Next verse. And having spoiled or led captive principalities, totally defeated in powers, demonic powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. The enemy's defeated. Next verse. Let no man, because this has been accomplished, let no man, not no demon, but let no man, watch this, therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, or the Sabbath. Don't let anybody judge you in those things, because Christ fulfilled them. Next verse. Which are a shadow, everybody say shadow, of things to come. At that time, they were a shadow of the things to come, but the body or the substance is Christ. Once you taste the substance, you lose all appetite for the shadow. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1 says, the law having a shadow of the good things to come, not the very image, can never with those sacrifices which they offered continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they have not ceased to be offered, because the worshipers once purged, everybody say once purged, should have no more conscience of sin. But I can't tell you, I talked to people at the bus barn, and somebody told me the other day, he said, oh, this preacher come in and he preached on sin is sin is sin is sin. I want to think, idiot, idiot. No, I'm sorry. Let me get nice on again. That's called ignorance. If you preach on sin, people become sin conscious. If you preach on Jesus, people become Jesus conscious. Amen. We're not to have any more conscious of sin. I talked to another guy and he said, yeah, the preacher preached on sin. I go, how's that working for you? You know what I see with these people? They have no hunger for God. God's not exciting to them. Because every time you go and it's all you hear about sin, you think, well, what a sorry old wretch I am. How many, see, you know why people, the ministry of the Holy Spirit's played down so much? Do you know why? Because, well, he's convicting you. Oh, I'm looking here. They think he's convicting you of sin. How would you like to hang out with somebody every time you turn around? You're wrong again. Okay. I see that thought. Don't do that. I'm got you. Who wants to hang out with the Holy Ghost if he's doing that? He's convicting you of righteousness is what it says in John 16. He's convicting you that you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He's trying to help you see who you are. It's the law that points out your lack and your failure. Glory to God. The Holy Spirit's trying to show you awake to righteousness, and then you'll sin not. Hallelujah. So it's through the eyes of grace. Grace is favor. Grace is the very essence of who Jesus was. People, the Bible, I'm going to give you these quickly. I'm just about done, and then we'll go to John chapter, John 5. Yeah, that's where I'm after. John chapter 5. Verse 39. See, you could search the scriptures and miss Jesus. Miss that it's about what he did. And I got a whole thing I'm going to talk about. Jesus Christ and his finished work. And then we're going to talk about, you know, Jesus don't want you to stop at Jesus. It's quiet here, isn't it? Jesus is about, he's the way to the Father heart of God. We're going to get into that. So see somebody, oh, just come to Jesus. Do you know that's biblically not accurate? Yes, come to Jesus, but Jesus is the way to the Father. It's all about a family. We're going to get there. Search the scriptures, he told them, for in them, he told these religious folks, you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Next verse. And ye will not come to me that you might have life. So it is come to Jesus, but he is the way to the Father. All right? Now, let me say this about the shadow. Imagine what we talked about. Imagine if I was in the cold North Pole for years and years and years, and I come back and I was all burly and had enough hair to comb it over here so it looked like I had big, thick hair. And all of a sudden, I see my wife. She's on the other end of the parking lot. I get off of the plane and, you know, slow motion. We're running like this, slow motion. We haven't seen each other for years. She's running. And all of a sudden, I get right up to her, and all of a sudden, I fall down and start hugging her shadow. Well, his brain froze, right? But that's what a lot of people are doing. They're hugging the shadow. You hear it on Christian TV all the time. Observe this feast day. This feast day, it's Passover season. It's Pentecost season. It's tabernacles. You're hearing all that garbage. That's old covenant. Amen? And I say garbage in the sense that they're making it about that shadow rather than the substance of who Christ is. The Bible says, in 1 Corinthians 5:7, Christ Jesus is our Passover. Who's your Passover? Jesus. Now, I want to close with this. I got 45 minutes, but I just want to close with this. I really do. I'm trying to get done early because I know it's Mother's Day. And I know we got coupons up here for the Asian buffet, but if you're getting there today, I want to shake your hand. All right? Listen to this from the old timer. A victorious confession or testimony. Once again, I said this earlier. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.